happy that you have chosen to be here today. We know that there's many places where you can be, but you chose to be here to worship God, and we want to welcome you for that. I just want to share a few brief announcements. As you know, we are no longer putting in your hands a written bulletin, but there is information that goes out every single week about things or ways in which you can connect virtually, and we put it out on our Facebook group called Brown Chapel. So I just want to highlight just a couple of things. One of those things is that every week we have a prayer focus, and this week our prayer focus, and we use the calendar week, right, from Sunday through Saturday. So this coming week, I should say, because we're still in the week, this coming week the prayer focus is to pray, to ask God to give you someone to minister to before 2020 ends. And that doesn't mean that you haven't been doing that, but ask for someone else. Remember the story of Desmond Doss when he was saving his unit? He kept asking God, please give me one more. Please give me one more. So set aside some time to ask God to give you one more person that you can minister to before this year ends. And I also want to encourage you to go there. There's information on how to join our prayer meeting, which right now takes place on Thursdays at 8 p.m. over the phone. There's also information on some training that is happening from our union virtually. And at the end of each of those little virtual bulletins, there's an activity. And the goal of the activity is that you dig into your past, look into your future, or look around you at your present, and just post something and interact with the rest of the church virtually, the church family. And for this upcoming week, the activity is going to be to share a post on the group, Brown Chapel Facebook group, with a picture of the earliest Christmas that you have a picture of you celebrating. And then just tell us the story behind the picture. And that doesn't mean that you have to go all the way back into your childhood. If you don't have that picture, that's fine. Just look through your photos, the earliest that you can find, you were there in the picture, and just tell us about it. And let's begin to get in the spirit of the Advent. These are the announcements, and now it's time for our praise team to come and lead us to the throne of God through music.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Actually, we're coming up in stages today. Kelly's going to join us for the second song, but I picked a song that she'd never heard before for the first song, so I'm not going to make her come up for that one. The first song we're going to do is God of Our Fathers. I love this song. I grew up singing it. It is one of my favorite songs. And I love it for the music. There's trumpets, there's, you know, it's this wonderful, bombastic song. But it took a long time of doing this before I actually started listening to the words. So I want to read the first verse, because when you read it, it comes out very differently than how you sing it. And I want you to really think about this wonderful song that we're singing about the God of our fathers and of ourselves. God of our fathers, whose almighty hand leads forth in beauty all the starry band of shining worlds in splendor through the skies, our grateful songs before thee arise. When we sing it, we don't realize that we're talking about the starry band of shining worlds. The God of our fathers, the God of us, is the God of an entire universe. And yet he takes care of us, and I love that. And I love that we can count on someone that mighty, that important, to take care of whether you can find your keys in the morning. So let's stand up and let's sing to the God of our fathers.
Thank you.
and it's just so sweet to trust in Jesus. The pastor, his sermon this week is on a promise, and we have been promised that we can trust in God, that we can trust in Jesus, and it is amazing, and it's so sweet. So we're going to sing, "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus." So And now I'm back to the verse. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his word.
The devil's seed and her seed.
Thank you so much to our praise team, Debbie and Kelly, for leading us through the throne of God with such wonderful melodies. And yes, I have to piggyback on those statements. There have been a few people that have been 100, 200, 500% committed so that we can continue not just to be able to have our building open, but also to be able to provide something for those who are connecting online. And I know that I've been saying this, but keep praying for us. The equipment is in. We just gotta get together to figure out how the intricacies of it work, and you will be able to get a little better presentation. One of the biggest changes that you'll be able to experience, those of you tuning in online, is when there are slides up in the screen, you will be able to see them full-blown in your screen. And you're also going to be able to get a little better sound quality. So one of the things that is neat about the ways in which we have been grown through this pandemic is that we, in essence, are getting set up so that we can do more effective ministry to those who are unable to come here in person. And even before the pandemic, we had members that for various reasons were unable to come, whether it is health or transportation or distance at that particular Sabbath. So now, once we get all this worked out, that group of people are going to be able to be here with us, so to speak, live every Sabbath with or without the pandemic. And that's thanks to people like Mark, who's been there faithfully. Thanks to people like his wife, Helen, and Debbie putting together the music and bringing in people like Kelly and Jennifer to come in and be part of it. People like Lauren, who's been teaching our primary class faithfully when we're here, which is every other week. People like Bruce, making sure that there is a program in Sabbath school, and many others. And I thank each of you. And I want to say thank you to Pedro Medina for doing a wonderful job teaching Sabbath school today, for those of you that were here in person. I would like to start with a word of prayer, and then we're going to dive in. Ready? Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for being a loving and merciful God. Here we are, almost to the end of 2020. And there are moments when we wonder, where did the year go? Maybe because for a huge chunk of it, we have been concerned with this plague that has been bringing havoc to our communities, to our lives, for longer than we would want it to. But then in the midst of all that, you're still here. And we thank you and praise you for that. And that as today, as we open scripture and we dive into that beautiful promise, we ask that you help us to have our hearts ready to receive what you want to give. That, and I ask that it is you who speaks through me, not just me up here talking, but that you would use me today to bring you honor and glory. We pray this in Jesus' name, and may your will be done. Amen. God is great.
Above all things.
Above all things. Sounds great. Yes. I know that those of you online, you got it right. This is just something that Genesis 3. Particularly Genesis 3:15. Now, for those of you that are familiar with the stories in Genesis, you know that Genesis 3 is perhaps the most difficult chapter in all of Scripture. Not the most difficult chapter to understand, but the most difficult story to read. Because it comes right after a perfect world. And then things go completely wrong. And there's a reason for that. But in the midst of all that, we have Genesis 3:15, which is a promise. Through this month, here in the United States of America, we focused on the Advent. We focused on the birth of Jesus. And today, and the next two Sabbaths in the month, I want us to kind of zero in what this is really all about. Now, I don't know about you, but when I was growing up, even though I didn't get a lot of gifts, I did look forward to being able to unwrap gifts. Anybody guilty of that? But see, the Advent is not really about that. It's not really about what I can get. It's not even about what I can give. But rather, it is about what has already been given to us. And in this verse, in Genesis 3:15, we find this incredible promise that opens salvation to us. Now, I don't know about you, but I want to be saved. Do I have any takers?
Amen.
Now, sometimes when we look at salvation, we picture something that will happen, right? Something that is to come. Someday Christ will return, and someday I will be saved. But in the here and now, we are drowning in sorrows. We are drowning in turmoil. Our life is chaos. So maybe we need to rethink the salvation that God wants to give us. For you see, I believe that in Scripture we learn that the salvation that God wants to give us is far greater than some promise of something that will happen in the future, but rather it is something that we can experience today. Wouldn't that be amazing? Something that we can experience today. But it all rests in the power of a promise. And to illustrate this point, I want to tell you a story about Booker T. Washington, who describes meeting an ex-slave from Virginia in his book, Up From Slavery. And the story goes like this. He said that he found that this ex-slave, when he was still a slave, he made a contract with the slave owner. And the contract was that every year he was going to be able to pay a portion of the cost so that he can receive his freedom. Now, this happened a few years before the Emancipation Proclamation. And part of the contract says that while he was paying so that he can buy his freedom, right? While he was making payments so that he can buy his freedom, that he can work for whomever he wanted, whenever he wanted. So this lady knew that in Ohio, of all places, anybody have been to Ohio? In Ohio, of all places, he got a better wage. So he decided to move there. Now, as he is fulfilling this contract, which, by the way, was this agreement or promise between these two people, right? The slave owner didn't have to uphold to that. He didn't have to uphold to that, but that was a promise that they made to each other, right? While this is happening, the Emancipation Proclamation took place. And when this happens, he still owed $300 on the contract. But when that happened, he was free. See, he no longer had to continue to make payments to buy his freedom. He was a free man. would you have done? I know what I think I would have done. I'd be like, okay, my debt is paid. Thank you, whoever paid it. I'm done with this. But this slave didn't do that. In fact, he walked a large portion of the way to be able to go back from hire to his master. By that time, former master. And place the last dollar of that debt with interest in his hand. Not because he had to, but because he had made a promise. See, when we understand the power of a promise, we realize that when a promise is being given, it will come to pass. Do you believe that? When a promise is being given by, and of course we're talking about an honest person. When a promise has been given by an honest person, it will come to pass. So go to scripture with me. Let's start right at the beginning there on verse 1. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field, which the Lord had made. And he said to the woman, God has indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it lest you die. Then the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die. For God knows that in the day that you eat of it, your eyes will open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and it was pleasant to the eyes, a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of it, of its fruit, and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. So in these first few verses of this very sad story, we see that Adam and Eve decided to disobey God. Have you ever been disobedient? Oh, now you're not raising your hands. What about you watching from home? Have you ever been disobedient?
Yeah.
I know I have. But it's not easy, right? Admitting that. But when we disobey, right, whatever it is that we're disobeying, there are natural consequences to our disobedience. But also, when we disobey, whatever it is that we're disobeying, the person or the entity that we are disobeying is under no obligation to restore us. Did you catch that? The person or the entity that we disobey is under no obligation to restore us, because the reason why there is consequences to our disobedience is because we knew that we were not supposed to do this, but yet we did it. Or we knew that we were supposed to do this, and we didn't do it. So the entity or the person whom we disobey does not have to go out of their way to make a path for us to be whole again. They don't have to do that. It's on us. So here we have Adam and Eve. They were in a perfect world, in this beautiful garden. They have the greatest time ever. Can you imagine plants that never die? Can you imagine tending for those plants? You can actually grow to attach yourself and love that plant, because it's always going to be there. You don't have to worry about losing it. That's the world that they lived in. Can you imagine doing just maintenance work, but whenever you went to the garden, the fruits were there for the taking so that you can enjoy, and they would have been the most amazing fruit the earth not tainted by sin yet. That's what they were giving up. And I don't know if you got it, but in the story, what drew her in was the serpent saying, "You will be like God, knowing good and evil." Is it possible that as a humanity we still struggle with that? We still struggle with the temptation of wanting to be like gods? Of wanting to be the gods of our own destinations? Of wanting to do everything on our own strength rather than depending on our Creator? Is it possible that we still struggle with the same temptation? Adam and Eve failed to withstand the temptation. They gave in. They messed up. And God could have simply just started over. He could have just simply gotten rid of the two of them and formed another man from the dust of the ground and put him to sleep again and remove a rib from his rib cage and form another woman and bring it to him. He could have done that. But in this story, not only do we see the brokenness of humanity when we choose to walk away from God, but we also see the incredible Creator that we serve. That rather than do that, He decided to save them. Now, just an interesting fact here. At the end there of those verses that we read, it says, "Then the eyes of both of them were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings." Now I want to read a portion of a statement here found in the Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 1, page 25, first paragraph, right? Just the first couple of sentences. It says, "The sinless pair wore no artificial garments. They were clothed with the covering of light and glory, such as the angels wear while they lived in obedience to God. This circle of life enshrouded them." So see, the reason why before they were also naked, but they were not ashamed, we read that in the previous chapter, is because they have this incredible God-given covering that shielded their nakedness. But when they sinned, they immediately lost that. So I want you to put yourself in their shoes. They knew what they had done. They knew what they had done. And they proceed to do something that we ourselves often do, which is, again, instead of coming to God with our brokenness, instead of coming to God with our mistakes, we try to hide it by trying to pull ourselves out of the mess. So, again, there in verse 7, it says that they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. Did you ever wonder why leaves? Did you ever wonder? I mean, they could have used mud, right? Wouldn't that be easier? Find one of those rivers that stem out from the garden, throw some dirt or water in there, mix it together, and just cover themselves. That would have been easier. So why leaves? So when I was dating my now wife, I went to visit her when she was attending Andrews University. And on a Friday evening, I believe, they had a worship service that was called Fusion. It was done in one of the dorms. And one of the presenters that day, he talked about this. And I'm like, wow, that's pretty neat. I haven't really seen that before. And here's what he talked about. He talked about photosynthesis. Have you ever heard that word? Are you smarter than a fifth grader? I don't know. Do they teach that in fifth grade? I don't know. So photosynthesis, Oxford Dictionary defined it this way: the process by which green plants and some other organisms use sunlight to synthesize food from carbon dioxide and water. Photosynthesis in plants generally involve the green pigment. So when you see that the green leaves on a plant or a tree, that's photosynthesis. It's the process by which they capture light. So when you see the tarnished, no longer green leaf on the floor, that means the light is gone from that leaf. So do you understand what they were doing? Rather than coming to God and say, God, we messed up. I know you told us not to eat this tree, not even to touch it, but we messed up. We ate from it. Instead of coming to God, they decided to go for the next best thing, right? They decided to put on them artificial light, so to speak. So they knew that life was trapped on those leaves, right? So they put them together and they covered themselves. But that wasn't enough. Because it doesn't matter how hard you try, you cannot save yourself. It doesn't matter how hard you try, you cannot fix your own problems. You can't. So let's continue. Verse 8. And they heard the sound of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, "Where are you?" So he said, "I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you that you should not eat?" Then the man said, "The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I ate." And the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me and I ate." So the Lord said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle, and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life." And here it is, verse 15. "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. And he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." God went looking for Adam and Eve. He knew what they had done. But he chose not to stay away from them. What do you do when God comes looking for you? Do you follow suit? Do you hide yourself from God? Now, before you answer that question to yourself, I want you to understand that in Scripture, we learn that one of the attributes of God is that he's omnipresent, which means he can be everywhere at once. And another attribute of God is that he's omniscient, which means that he knows all things. And another attribute of God is that he's omnipotent, which means that he's all-powerful, so he can do everything, anything. So when you put that into perspective, then you realize how foolish we are. How foolish we are when we deceive ourselves into thinking that we can hide from God. It's like, "Oh, I messed up. I don't want God to find out. So let me go here and hide myself. Oh, yeah, my life is a mess. I don't want God to find out. So I'm going to stop attending church. Because somehow if I'm not there, then he won't know that I'm a mess. That I haven't been spending time with him. That I haven't been reading the Bible. That I haven't been studying the Bible study that is provided for me to help me in my own journey to draw closer to God. Somehow, if I stop going to church, then he's not going to know that I haven't been a good parent. He's not going to know that I'm getting a good spouse. He's not going to know that I'm getting a good co-worker. But God is omniscient. And he's omnipresent. Which means that when you were messing up, he knew what you were doing. And when you were messing up, he saw you do it. But yet, you try to hide from God. It's foolishness. But if you're wondering where we get this from, well, we get this from our forefathers, our foreparents, who did exactly that. They hid from God as if he could not find them. But in his incredible love, he simply just calls out. So how is God calling out to you today? Is it a friend that sent you a text? Is it maybe something you read as you were driving down the road that pointed you back to the Word of God? Or was it just simply that when you walked by your library or by the end table or by the coffee table, you saw the Bible there? The Bible that you hadn't taken the time to read because you were too busy trying to fix your own problem. Is that how God is calling you? Or is it maybe the gentle rebuke of a friend calling you up? Is that how God is calling you? However he's calling you, I want you to know that when God calls you, he does that because he loves you. When God calls you, he doesn't do it because he wants to condemn you. He does it because he wants to save you. And what is incredible about this story is that in their conversation with God, both Adam and Eve, they start to blame others rather than assume responsibility. And then, instead of just simply laying out the law, God gives them a promise. He gives them this incredible promise. Go back to it with me in Genesis 3:15. I will put enmity between you and the woman. He's talking to the serpent. And between your seed and her seed, he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. Let me read a quote from the Andrews Bible commentary. It says, the divine verdict was first pronounced against the serpent, then Eve, and finally Adam. The Lord did not leave them in total darkness to face the death that will follow their rebellion and their claim of independence from him. Where there was no future for humanity, God provided one for them in Genesis 3:15. The first promise of redemption found in the Bible. Isn't that amazing? When two people who had everything chose to disobey God, God gives them a way back to him. Now, I know you know what is coming, and we're going to get there. But see, in this particular promise, the way back to God is through God. Did you catch that? The one who was going to fix the mess that they created was not them, but it was God himself. And it was God who delivered that promise. Now, I don't know about you, but you know, when I mess up, and my wife says, don't worry about it, I got you. Oh, that feels so good. This is what God is doing in this promise. But interestingly enough, he's talking to the serpent. He's not even talking to Adam and Eve yet. He's talking to the serpent. See, in the punishment to the serpent, we find redemption. redemption for humanity. And that redemption comes only through God. That's just amazing. In Hebrews 9:26, we read this. He then would have had to suffer often since the foundation of the world. But now, once at the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. See, the way back to God is through God, particularly Jesus Christ. So I want to encourage you, as you are meditating on this season, as you're getting ready for all the fun stuff that you are still going to do in spite of the pandemic, as you're figuring out which ways you're going to be able to connect with people, whether it is a small group or whether it is a phone call or whether it is a virtual gathering, I want to encourage you to meditate on this promise. The way back to God is through God. But the reason why today we have a chance at salvation is because this promise became a reality. And Jesus came. Amen? Jesus came. And he didn't come because he was looking forward to hanging out with his creation, although I'm sure he was. He didn't come so that he can prove that he can do it. He knew he could. He's omnipotent. He came because he knew that if he didn't come, you and I cannot be safe. He came to save you. That's it. In Revelation 13:8, we read, all who dwell on the earth will worship him, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. See, I want you to understand that God knew that he was going to have to step in. But he still created Adam and Eve. Now, you want to talk about love? Think of a couple that know that they're going to go through some horrible challenges should they decide to stay together. But because they love each other, they stay together. See, if they don't stay together, the challenges go away. But because they love each other, they stay together and they work through those challenges by God's grace. See, God knew that he was going to have to step in. God knew that he was going to have this conversation with Adam and Eve. And he also knew that he could easily just not create them and this will never happen. But he loved them too much not to have them ever exist. Now I want you to place yourself there. Because you and I, we are descendants of Adam and Eve. You and I are the children of their children's children. You and I are here because God created them. No them, no us. So when God created them and he knew that he was going to have to step in because they were going to mess up royally, he was also thinking about you. Now, when you allow yourself to believe that, when you allow yourself to believe that, do you understand now how much he loves you? Do you think that if he loves you that much, he's not going to be able to help you to fix your problems with your spouse? Do you think that if he loves you that much, he's not going to give you a helping hand as you're trying to win your children back? Do you think that if he loves you that much, he's not going to help you with that health issue or with that financial issue or with that relational issue? Of course he will. And all that is possible because he came. John, talking about Jesus, says, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." See, that's why this promise is so meaningful. Because in this promise, right from the very beginning, we don't know how long time passed between them singing and Jesus and God talking to them, but likely not a long time. So at the very beginning, God says, "Hey, I am going to step in, and I am going to redeem you, but it's going to cost me." I don't want us to miss that. See, "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed, he shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." See, God was going to step in to fix the mess that was created by his creation, and it was going to cost them. When was the last time that you did that? When was the last time that somebody wronged you so deeply that maybe you are still even hurting from what was done to you? But yet, knowing that it was going to cost you, you stepped in. And you fixed it. Now, of course that's not easy to do. Nobody wants to do that. Who wants to go make peace with somebody who's giving you grief? That's the last thing you want. You want to stay away from that as much as possible. But that is not what God did. God stepped in. Now, please, 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 don't misunderstand. You are not God. I'm not God. I couldn't do it. If I was God, we all would be dead. Because I couldn't do it. So I'm not saying, go fix it. What I'm saying is, give it to God. Let him fix it. Because this promise of God stepping in is a promise that gives you salvation today. Not a promise that gives you salvation merely in the future. And if you're wondering if this promise applies to you, I want you to listen to the words of Paul to the Galatians in chapter 3, verses 16 and 29. He says, "Now Abraham and his seed were the promise made. To Abraham and his seed were the promise made. He does not say, 'And to seeds as of many,' but as of one, 'And to your seed, who is Christ.'" And verse 29, "And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise." So this promise that God was going to step in, even though it was going to cost them, is not just a promise to Adam and Eve, but it's a promise to you and me. If we are Christ. So the question is very simple. Are you Christ? Do you belong to him? Do you receive him as your Lord, your Savior, and your Master? Because if you do, then this is your promise. And this promise simply says, you made a mess, and God says, I'm going to fix it. Isn't that nice? I made a mess, but he's going to fix it. Hebrews 2. 14 and 15. "Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of the flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear and death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." God came to set you free. That's the reason for this season. God came to set you free. So what is it that still has you in bondage? Is it an addiction? Is it ill feelings that you're harboring against someone? Is it insecurities? Because you don't believe that you are able. In Genesis 3:15, we are told that you don't have to be able because He is able. In a Bible commentary, the Bible speaks today, the message of Hebrews, we read, our high priest has put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. The word used at the sin, put away, abolish, do away with, literally means that Christ came for the disannulling of sin. It is the same word as used in Hebrews 7:18 when our writer says to the law concerning priesthood was set aside because of its weakness and uselessness. In other words, by Christ's death, it is not only that the devil is deposed and the power of death overcome, but also that sin is vanquished. Jesus came to rob sin of his tyranny and his suffocating stranglehold on men. Obviously, sin is still at large in the world, just as death and the devil are still active. But all three have been robbed of their former hold on men. In Christ, we are free from their enslaving power. So today, not tomorrow, not the next day, today you can make a choice. And the choice is very simple. You can choose to be free because God has set you free through His Son, Jesus Christ. Today, you can choose to be saved because Jesus has already saved you. There's a book of illustrations titled Illustrations That Connect, over 100 illustrations for preachers, teachers, and public speakers, and it's a long subtitle. But in this book, there's a story about a little girl who decided to get up early in the morning and fix breakfast for her mother and her father. She spent quite some time mixing the different ingredients. And when her father finally came to the kitchen was a mess. But the little girl asked him, before he said anything, to read the note. And this is what the note says. I know things seem like they are a mess now, but I'm working on something. See, when I read Genesis 3:15, I am reminded of this incredible promise. And even though right now, things in the world, things perhaps in your own life, things, you know, definitely in our church, I mean, if you look around you, you know who's missing. They're not here because they don't want to be here. They're not here because of the stuff that is going on and how it is affecting them or hindering them from gathering together. But as we look around at this mess, I want you to be reminded through this verse that God is working on something. And the end of that is going to be this incredible feast where we all to rejoice with the Lamb who was slain before the foundation of the world, to rejoice with the Lamb through whom our sins are taken away, to rejoice with the Lamb who is the Son of God. And that Lamb was promised right at the beginning. See, God knew that you and I one day were going to pick up the Bible and we were going to begin reading at the beginning. And he knew that when we read the story of creations in the first two chapters, we were going to be excited at this incredible thing that he created. And he also knew that then we're going to compare that incredible creation with the mess that is our world. And he knew that when we read Genesis 3, we were going to be heartbroken and we were going to start blaming Adam and Eve. How dare you? If it wasn't because of what you did, I would not be in this mess today. So he knew that before we get past chapter 3, we needed to know that this messed up world that we often find ourselves living in, this isn't the end. So let me close with this. He stepped in, but he knew that it was going to cost him. See, he was going to crush the head of the serpent, but the serpent was going to bruise his heel. A friend of mine was doing evangelism at one of my churches when I was still pastoring in Central Illinois. We were in the All Nations Seventh-day Adventist Church. And in his series, he talked about this passage. And he put up a slide on the screen, this nice depiction of a man that for the sake of the story was Jesus, just lifting his heel with sandals, and a snake just looking at it. And then I got it. See, as this foot with a sandal came down on the snake was going to bite, and he was going to bruise the heel of that man crushing the head of the serpent. And that happened at the cross. At the cross, Jesus was wounded by Satan. But he didn't stay there. He resurrected the third day. And we look at that story and we're so thankful. We're so thankful because of what Jesus has done for us. But I want you not to forget one thing. That story, which is promised in this verse, does not happen unless there is a birth. The birth came first. So during this season, as we remember the birth, remember that the birth is a fulfillment of a promise that simply says, through my son, you will be safe. That is what God is saying to you in his word. So I want to ask you a question as I close. Simple question. Are you willing to receive Jesus as the promise to your salvation? Not the salvation of the people around you. Not the salvation of the church you attend. Not the salvation of those Christians. Are you willing to accept Jesus as the promise to your salvation? Regardless of what problem you're struggling with today, are you willing to accept Jesus as the promise to your salvation? If you're willing to do that, I'd like to pray with you. I encourage you to stand at this moment. And those of you that are watching from home, are you willing to accept Jesus as the promise to your salvation? Whatever it is that you're struggling with, the Bible says that the answer has a name, and his name is Jesus. Are you willing today to accept him as the promise to your salvation. And if you're wondering, is it possible that he can save me? The answer is yes. If you're wondering, is his promise real? The answer is his promises of salvation is as real as the promise of his coming, and he did come. Which means that the rest is on his way. So I want to encourage you, whatever device you're using, phone, tablet, computer, type right there, Jesus is the promise of my salvation. Jesus is the promise of my salvation. Let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, blessed, precious, and glorious is your holy name. What an amazing promise you have given us in your word. We messed up. Yet, you're stepping in, even though it cost you. Thank you. Thank you for not looking at the suffering that you endure. Seeing your son on that cross. For not looking at that as something too great to do to save me. To save us. Thank you for loving me, loving us so much that in spite of the cost, you went ahead with your plan so that we can be saved. But that right now, the people who are standing, the people who typed on their devices, they are struggling with many things. And you know exactly what the struggle is, and they know exactly what the struggle is. That so I ask you that you will please give us the strength not to try to fix our lives, not to try to fix our problems, but rather teach us to surrender to you, to embrace the promise of Jesus, and to accept the fact that we don't need to save ourselves because you have already promised that you will save us. So that here we are broken, here we are with uncertainties, here we are with pains that we cannot withstand alone. Give us the strength to surrender all this to you and embrace your son. Teach us how to do this. That in doing so, your name alone will be glorified. And that I know that I myself, I get on the way so often. I get angry. I doubt. I blame other people. That thank you for telling me in Genesis 3:15, telling me in the story of Genesis that even when I am a mess like that, you still look for me and help me that to surrender all that nonsense that Satan is throwing my way, to just put it at your feet. To embrace the promise of your son and experience salvation. Help each of us, in whichever way we struggle, to put our struggle in your hands so that you can give us rest. That we pray this in Jesus' name, and may your will be done. Amen.
More.
choosing that song to close our message today. I want to leave you with this promise, or this blessing rather, from Numbers 6, verses 24 through 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord may his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.